America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Good evening, everybody. Mr. Alonso called and said he's ill and will not be with us this evening. Is there any public comment from the board? Any announcements? Okay, any public comment from the public? All righty, we'll get right down to business. Our first appointment is for Victory Distributors LLC, doing business as Hannaford Supermarket and Pharmacy, number 8388. And we have two items. One is a change of manager for the alcohol license, and one is a change of officers. You here to speak to that?
Yes.
Would you join us, please? Tell us who you are.
My name is Jennifer Moore.
Hi, Jennifer.
Hi.
And why don't you tell us what's going on?
Well, I'm here, I guess, for a change of manager. I'm not really sure. They just told me I had to be here.
Okay.
Nobody really told me what I was coming for. So.
Okay. Are you the new manager?
I am the new store manager there, yes.
Okay. Well,
congratulations.
Thank you.
Great. So we do have paperwork here for the change in manager.
Yes.
And I assume it meets all of our requirements.
Best I can tell, yes.
And we've done the...
It has been reviewed by the executive assistant, and everything seems to be in order.
Okay. Any questions or comments?
So you're going to be in charge of the whole store?
Yes.
All right. Effective when?
It was effective October 24th.
Oh.
Yes. So I've been there, I think, almost 8 weeks now.
You've been in this store before, have you not?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, I thought so. Right. And where are you coming from? What store are you in?
Previously in Gardner.
Okay.
And also in Lancaster Street in Leominster.
Mm-hmm.
I would make a motion that we approve the change of manager for Jennifer Moore and to change the officers as submitted in their application.
I'll just give you all of them.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Thank you.
Aye.
Aye. Congratulations.
Aye, thank you very much.
We'll sign all this paperwork and have it available for you at the Selectman's office.
Okay.
It's earliest tomorrow, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck.
Good night.
Thank you.
Is it?
Yeah.
Three altogether. Okay. All righty. We have a 7:15 appointment. We'll move down to our current business until we get to 7:15.
Do you want to hold that for your 7:15?
Yes, please. We do have a license renewal, though, for Whalum Gas.
Whalum Gas for Automatic Amusement and Common Victualler. They have two video games for their automatic amusement, and then they serve food for their common vic.
Okay.
Everything is in order.
Oh, it's at the corner.
Okay. Is that the one that's on Summer Street, the corner of Summer Street? Yeah.
Stella's gas price is at 96 cents.
It's easy to do when there's no pumps.
That's right. I make a motion we approve the common victualler and automatic amusement devices for Whalum Gas.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
There's two there.
So there's three.
That's it.
Yep.
Two signatures there. All righty. Let's see. We have some minutes for November 8th. We have some warrants. Okay. I have one that's a reissued one that was voided, and that is for payroll in the amount of, is that a negative? Yeah, negative $939.46. So that's a bookkeeping.
It's actually, I think they missed one.
Yep. And I have one for school construction in the amount of $437,259.62. And an accounts payable in the amount of $163,183.75. Are there any action file issues?
Yes, I have something to bring up. I was really glad that we took the action to set up the workshop for February to discuss the spring pavement management projects. But to ensure the productivity of this workshop, I think it's going to be important to identify what we're trying to accomplish and what information we'll need ahead of time so that we're able to reach our goals. You know, I think we need list of the streets paved so far under the debt exclusion and list of streets to be paved in 2017, debt exclusion and regular pavement. And of course, identify the date of the workshop. As road commissioners, you know, it's our duty to maximize the benefit of these newly paved roads. And with this information, the Stormwater Task Force can get in there and take a look at these roads too and see how we can help the DPW address the direction of stormwater runoff off the roads to preserve the integrity of the roads, reduce roadway flooding and pollution entering the waterways. And it'll be a win-win for us.
I also think in addition to that information, we need to have an overview of what improvements can be made on the various paving projects and those in the future that fit in line with the Complete Streets program. So if there are intersections, for example, that could be upgraded, or if there are areas that could be multimodal, if there are suggestions or sharrows that can be put on roadways, that kind of information is something I would like for that workshop to determine whether or not we should move forward with the Complete Streets program.
The only thing on that is that I thought that the Complete Streets process was to get planning money to figure out what that is, because I don't think Jack has done any work, nor we have directed him to do any work to identify which streets would meet that.
Well, my issue is that the Complete Streets program is basically a contract saying that we're going to adopt this Complete Streets principles. And in doing so, we basically make a commitment that we're going to fit in line with that. If we have to have some idea before I'm willing to enter into a contract saying that we're going to do Complete Streets, I'd like to have some idea. And maybe it's not all of them, but at least some idea of what improvements can be made in order to meet the requirements of the Complete Street program. So I'd really like to have, instead of just a general overview, I'd like to have a better understanding of what can be done. And one of the things I was going to bring up under my updates for meetings is that Montechusett Regional Planning Commission is looking to assist communities with the Complete Streets program. So they're actively searching for communities that are interested in that program. And that might be an avenue we want to explore. And that would obviously be a no funding requirement. So, you know, I certainly think we could touch base with them at least to get an idea of an overview of the kind of improvements they're doing for other communities. Because I think there's certainly an opportunity on the table, but I want to make sure that we're not looking at it as an opportunity to get the $400,000 in funding, which I think is also, it's not just for planning, it's for the actual improvements.
I hope so.
But I also want to ensure that the we have them. Sometimes if we're going to make a roadway multimodal, for example, and we're going to make a 4-foot wide pathway, there's costs associated with maintaining that. You know, vegetation maintenance, etc. It might seem like an easy fix, but we can't only look at the short-term improvement, but the ongoing cost, and to make sure that we can incorporate in that and we can fund it. So I think it's a bigger discussion, and I'd like to at least touch on it during that workshop to really get an understanding of whether we believe we should apply for this funding.
Okay, I think I understand Mrs. Luck's request, and I think that's something that the DPW director can bring to the workshop.
Mm-hmm.
What I guess I don't understand, and I agree we need the data you talked about, what's the expectation? Who would bring that to the workshop?
I would think that it would be our DPW director. I would think that he would give an idea in looking at the pavement. So, for example, if we're going to pave six roads, but three of those have intersections which would really benefit from some improvements, whether it be line marking or whether it be...
Okay.
Then I think we need to know that going into the paving season.
So that's different than what I was understanding. I was thinking you were asking for the entire town.
No. I'd like to understand if we really believe that some of those streets could benefit from the Complete Street program, then we should move ahead with the application. But without knowing that, whether I'd be.
Right, but that's actually that's kind of a. An outcome of the workshop, right? To have that discussion.
Well, I would think that Mr. Rodequins would be able to identify, okay, you know, we've got an intersection here that has been problematic because the DPW gets called for crashes.
Right.
You know, there's guardrails that really need to be replaced and we could really use a bike lane here. We should have that discussion before we do the paving rather than after.
Agreed. I guess my question is that the taking that data and having that discussion and using it to determine whether we want to pursue...
We'll do that after, but I would
whether
like...
Whether we want to pursue
but I would
complete
like,
streets
right, but
is one of the action items from the,
absolutely,
for the workshop.
Absolutely.
Okay.
But I would like Mr. Rodequins to bring with him to the workshop an overview of what, in addition to just paving,
uh-huh,
what other improvements would he recommend on the roadways that he's proposing that could potentially benefit from participating in the Complete Streets program.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Is that clear?
Yeah. Now, you can contact Jack. And
I can.
Okay.
And
to
add a little bit of clarity to the money, it's up to $50,000 for planning.
Right.
And should the plan meet the requirements, there's $400,000 of construction funding available for qualifying projects.
Okay.
Okay.
And it's true, it's not necessarily a no-brainer that it's going to be a good fit for us right now.
Right, exactly.
And I think another valuable input will be the new town manager's experience with Complete Streets in her prior town. I mean, obviously different set of data, but she has done some Complete Street work and can contribute to that. And that's
the program is the program.
Right. So do we want to talk about picking a date to schedule that?
I think that would be great.
I have three Tuesdays in February.
So we should probably not have the third, maybe the second.
That'll give the new town manager about a month on board.
In February?
Yeah, so that would be the 14th of February.
Which is Valentine's Day, just an FYI.
You can all love the road program.
It's a hard thing to do.
Do we want to tentatively set it for that? And if we hit any roadblocks, we'll talk about it again?
Roadblocks?
Okay. Yeah, no pun intended.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so while we're on the subject of scheduling and a different action file issue, is we were, I was discussing with the acting town manager that we did get four responses, nine responses, excuse me, to our request for proposals or information?
Proposals.
Request for proposals for a town...
council.
Town council. And we have to schedule a time to review those proposals. And I would like to suggest that we try to do that on the fourth Tuesday in February and dedicate the whole meeting. We don't usually meet on the last Tuesday of the month. Dedicate the whole meeting to reviewing those nine proposals. Not that we'll come to a decision that night, but dedicate that night to reviewing the nine different proposals.
That's
an excellent idea. So if that pleases the board, we'll hold then the 14th for the workshop on pavement management, and we'll hold the 28th for review of the town council proposals.
And I'd suggest on the 28th we start at 6, since we have so much to
do. And by way of information, the RFP calls for a 10-minute presentation and questions for each respondent. So if you budget 20 minutes for each person, you're in a 3-hour meeting. And I would also suggest or ask if you'd like us to book a room at the school so you have audiovisual capabilities, you have it locked down now, and then if something changes, you have the ability to move it. But at least that way you're putting it into motion and you know where it'll be. I also don't know that you want to televise town council. I mean, I don't know that it matters one way or the other. It's an open meeting. It's public, but you may, as you all know, get better dialogue without the third eye.
I'd suggest that we get a camera that we then broadcast it afterwards. It doesn't need to be live.
Yeah, I would agree.
And I think that's reasonable.
That night is a sewer commission meeting, so that could go, and then we could do it another time.
Okay, that's my concern, is that, you know, I don't want to bump sewer from this slot and the TV possibility. Right. But if we can get an alternative that also has TV possibility, I have no problem with that.
Right.
I agree.
All right, so we'll work on those two dates as we move forward. Okay. Any other action file issues?
Two things. During the winter, I'd like to do the workshop on our policies, specifically regarding the boot drive. I know it was discussed last week. Several people contacted me about not being happy with boot drives, regardless of anyone doing it and not doing that. But I would like to just get some clarity on town property usage. The band concert this season, there was one that was sponsored by a political party, and there was political signs out there on town property, which I'm not sure whether is legal or not. So I just generally want to look at what use of town property and our authority and what sort of requirements we should have as policies, because once we allow one entity in to do something someplace, then any other entity, regardless of what their entity is, would be able to come in and do it unless we have a policy. So I just want to have something over the winter before next season's use of town property.
Okay.
Well, I agree, it's much clearer to have a policy in place.
Now, where do we stand on the whole policy manual thing?
It was completed.
Right.
Subject to some individual chapters. I'm not sure if Carrie finished the things she needed. It's probably, I mean, we said we
Elaine,
would.
Elaine, you know, I had done the first draft, and then Elaine kind of took it over, and so she's been maintaining any changes we make.
I think we said we were going to review it every year to see if there's anything we want to change.
I'd just like to, if we're going to do it, I'd like to do the bigger issue and do them all, right?
Yeah. I think what would be good, again, to just have the workshop where we go through the table of contents. We say, similar to town meeting, we say hold or this is fine or whatever, and then just come back and then come up with a work plan over the next year to update everything.
I would agree.
So we'd be able to have it ahead of time so we could look it over.
Yeah,
so I would think March or April we would want to do that to give us plenty of time to look at it.
Okay, will do. And I just got last year's budget schedule that we have to share with the new town manager and see if she's going to do it on the same schedule or adjust that in any way. And that'll inform a lot of where our busy points are and where we can fit workshops.
Have the budget worksheets gone out to the department heads yet?
I don't know. Do you know?
I do know. They have not. Due to a staffing deficiency in the accounting office, everything is slightly delayed. In speaking with the town accountant, they should be out just after the first of the year, which would have them back in probably the week that the new town manager begins. And in the past, town manager's budget presentation has been mid to late February for the opening, with the budget public hearing being in March. So we're compressing the timeline for department heads to get their budgets in. I imagine we'll be looking at a level of service, you know, level service funding. So it should be a fairly easy negotiation of developing budgets for most departments. And I think that the majority of us have at least started looking at our numbers and where we'll be.
Okay. Under the charter, I believe the town manager is required to have the budget to the FinCom and to us by February 15th. Is that correct?
Yes, which is...
So my question is that a realistic expectation, or do we have the ability to modify that?
I believe it's a realistic expectation.
Okay.
If, and, you know, that is all things being equal. The town accountant has worked on the budget for many years. I think that if she's involved at this front end all the way through when the new town manager gets here, I don't think there'll be any radical changes to it. I think we'll be using a lot of the assumptions from the previous town manager and using a lot of the forecasting models that are already in place. So it may not be the full budget experience that the incoming town manager will do the next year, but I think that hitting the timelines that we need to hit and following the schedule that we follow on a regular basis shouldn't be... It shouldn't be impossible. There may be some challenges at the front end getting up to speed, but I don't think it's insurmountable.
Okay, thank you.
It's a discussion we've been having for about a month now, and we are aware that we're sort of up against it.
Okay, thank you.
And the new town manager needs to take time in February too, right?
Mm-hmm. Did he?
The new town manager has a prior vacation.
Yeah.
Scheduled, so she's going to miss some time in February as well.
Yeah, I think it's a like a 1 week that she'll need to work around. But I agree with what Mr. Burney just said. It's the finance director is kind of carrying the normal process through, and we're expecting the new town manager to kind of if she wants to make adjustments or add her own style to it, if you will. Mm-hmm. My guess is it will still be on the schedule that we're familiar with.
Okay.
Unless we get different.
I can certainly I plan to reach out to the incoming town manager on the legal scheduling and make sure there's nothing that she would like to add or see included in that, and I can certainly, you know, get any thoughts that she might have on how that budget process might work and ensure that she's comfortable with where we're moving.
Okay. All right. So is that action file issues? Is that all of them?
All set.
All righty. So our 7:15 appointment is Tom Bertram is here with the Lunenburg Snow Riders and two or three updates and a request. Take it away, Tom.
So you guys have a copy of my presentation in front of you?
Yes, we do.
Good, because the high-tech cable is on my desk. So we're going to be going through this manually. First of all, thank you very much for having me tonight. Tom Bertram, 312 Townsend Harbor Road. I'm here tonight representing the Lunenburg Snow Riders. So my agenda for you tonight is short and sweet. I won't take a lot of your time here, provided my computer cooperates, which it is suddenly not doing. Are you kidding me?
Here.
Thank you.
You can do it the manual way.
The computer can work 364 days a year. So my agenda tonight is I want to go over the our 2013 RTP grant, our 2015 RTP grant, and then our actual reason for being here tonight is the request to dedicate a bridge to Peter Charpentier. So let me say first, define what an RTP grant is, because a lot of people don't know this. RTP stands for Recreational Trails Program. It's a grant system administered by DCR at the state level, And the funds come from the federal gas tax. So basically, a certain percentage of your, every gallon of gas you buy is tax money. A lot of that money goes to your road and highway improvements. But the federal government realizes that ATVs, snowmobilers, also pay these taxes, and so this is a way to get that money back. A lot of the money goes to, there's three buckets of funds. There are non-motorized use, motorized use, and combined use. We've been very successful as the snow riders in accessing those funds under the combined use. So a lot of the programs and the things that we do are multi-use, multi-use trails, meaning they're not only used for snowmobiling, but they're used for pedestrians, hikers, kayakers. We see all kinds of crazy things on the
trails.
So the 2013 grant, we're closing out this year. The grants typically have a two-year life cycle, although you can extend them. 2013 year was in particularly a late grant because of some state funding. But basically, the primary task that we did on this is we repaired some erosion in the Cowdery Conservation Area off of Mulpus Road, an old tote road, and Muskrat Swamp Road. You can see here on the right-hand side, if you see the photos, we had a bunch of some tractors and a lot of volunteers. Basically, what's happened down there is the beavers have built up the dammed the waterway up, and then the water has eroded the trail out, and it's all rooted. So we brought gravel down there, and we repaired those trails. We also, at the request of the Lunenburg Conservation, we built a handicapped, we're calling it a viewing station. It's basically a deck down on the Harold Harley site. We improved the road down there and have to give access to it. We created a kiosk. And it's actually a nice area. So I don't know if anyone's had a chance to do that, but that's a piece of property that is well underused in Lunenburg. It's right off of Townsend Harbor Road. So that grant was in excess of $24,000. And for the club, we actually got some trail grooming equipment, a drag, to help groom the trails in the winter. We also made a connector trail going from the Cowdery lot on Mulpus Road to the small town forest on Mulpus Road. So now you can by trail connect those two properties, which hasn't been done in a long time. You can see here some pictures of us actually creating a kiosk. And that lovely gentleman on the right in front of that orange piece of equipment, that is our drag that we bought. And that is me modeling. I expect that to be my next career, model snowmobile parts. So the remaining tasks in the 2013 grant are to add some more gravel or trail maintenance to the large town forest. And one of the things you'll see in when we start talking about the 2015 grant is one of the main goals of the 2015 grant was to create meaningful access to the large town forest so that we can get out there and do that that trail work. So we're closing out that 2013 grant and moving on to the 2015 grant. So the 2015 grant was it was almost entirely dedicated to the Lane property. So as you all know, that in 2014, the town purchased the, I think it's 175 plus or minus acres of the property off of Holman Street. The club put together a grant for the RTP program to put in a parking lot there, and also to improve the main trail, to connect that main trail from the Lane property into the large town forest and provide meaningful access. And so that meaningful access in this case meant a pretty significant bridge. So this program was put together at our first appointment, and we've actually we've had a significant work session since that. But at the date of this, which is the beginning of December, we had logged 385 hours of volunteer time and equipment operators to the equivalent of $12,000. So we get these are reimbursement grants, and we do in-kind donations. And our in-kind donation typically comes in donations of labor and equipment. So that $12,000 is a direct payment back to the grant. So we did complete the construction of the parking lot. We created 5-foot bridges on a new trail that parallels the Mulpus. If you haven't been back there, it's just gorgeous. You need to do that. So we did acquire a new power unit for grooming, and we constructed a bridge, which we're going to talk about a little bit here, across the Mulpus. So a couple of things that are remaining on this grant and left to do in the Lane property is we are going to create a kiosk. There are some culverts we need to repair. The road improvements we've actually completed. We put down over 205 ton of material on the trail between the parking lot and the first turn, and that if you've ever been out there, there was a really low spot where it was all rutted out. We put down 4 to 6 inches of material, I want to say 1,500 yards as long or something, but it was quite significant. So big kudos for all of our friends, local excavator teams, Proctor, Powell, Ramsden, and Lakeview have all been very instrumental in donating equipment and time and getting us through this. So, and the last thing we need to do is trail marking. So as we continue on, we have a couple of pictures here of some of our accomplishment. The first one is the groomer. So this is a $10,000 machine that we purchased through the grant for grooming the trails within the Lunenburg and Middlesex and Worcester County. There's a couple of pictures of the parking lot, and again, big kudos to the Powell brothers. We could not have possibly done all this without the amount of effort and donations that the Powell has given to us.
Is that the Lane property, the parking
yes.
lot?
Yeah, that's the Lane property off of, that parking lot is open to the public, that is it is available, that's a beautiful piece of property. It connects, again, to the large town forest and all the way to Hickory Woods, which is now in Chapter 61, so that is open public, Hickory Woods is public property, and it's just a beautiful, I think there's 450 contiguous acres out there or something.
One thing, just to mention, one thing that has been talked about is moving the, as you know, as part of the grant, we had to put up a sign notifying that it's a Lane property. Originally, the plan was to put the handicapped parking further down by the Jersey barrier and right along the Mulpus. However, the handicapped parking was actually put alongside the road, and it's also available, the parking lot is available. So what we want to talk to the DPW director about is moving that sign, because a lot of people don't realize that parking lot is for the Lane property. So it makes sense to put the sign further up the road.
I think once we get a kiosk out there, it'll help it too. Because right now, you know, there's logging going up the street, and if you drive down there, you're like, who's where, right? So maybe some signage would help. I agree. So here's some pictures of us working on the bridge. This was we have over $5,000 in material and bridges out there, which is, you know, pretty significant. But we have a ball. We have a lot of fun with it. So if anyone's interested, we have members of the Lunenburg Snow Riders who don't even know what snowmobiles are. Well, they know what they are, but they don't operate them. We have people, because we do a lot. We have a great partnership with Lunenburg Conservation. And so people are like, you're the guys out there working on the trails. I want to be out there working on the trails. If you're interested in it, we welcome hikers, bikers,
horseback riders,
whoever wants to help, you can reach out to me. You can find us on Facebook is the best way, which is Sled Lunenburg on Facebook. There's a couple of examples of the bridges we built. Most of these bridges, again, were pedestrian bridges. They're not wide enough for a machine. But we did build one significant bridge. And this bridge is the span across the river is 23 feet. It has a 10-foot ramp on one side and a 6-foot ramp on the other. It's 10 feet wide, and it's constructed with 6 telephone poles and 4x6 construction for the decking. So this is a significant bridge. The idea was this bridge is going to be big enough to run a machine across to get gravel out to improve the road on the other side of the bridge. We load-tested the bridge with an 8,000-pound machine. So live load tested with 8,000 pounds. So our goal is not to make this area an ATV or a Jeep area. That's not the goal by any stretch. But the goal is to make, again, meaningful access to get from the parking lot out to the town forest so that we can utilize that property. And that brings us to my request for you tonight. As a lot of members of our community are aware, Peter Charpentier was an avid outdoorsman, lifelong resident, or nearly lifelong resident, Lunenburg, lived down in Hickory Hills, was very active in a lot of different areas. This is not about snowmobiling. Peter was an outdoorsman, and our club is about outdoorsmen, about being outside and giving back to the community. We would like to dedicate the bridge we built to Peter, and we want to keep it very, just very simple, just a memorial plaque out there, something as simple as we have here in the text, something like in loving memory of Peter Charpentier, an avid outdoorsman, dedicated father, son, and friend. And we're hoping that that the selectmen will issue the proclamation allowing that. The conservation voted unanimously on their last meeting to support it, and we would like to do that just in memory of Peter. So that's kind of where I'm at tonight.
Any questions? Or
to start out by saying thank you to you and all the people that have been working on the Lane property and other properties. I was able to see the Lane property before you've done the work, and the Hare Harley place saw the dedication for that. So it's great to really make these accessible to everybody. And I'm in full support of the proposed proclamation.
Yeah, I'd also like to congratulate the Snow Riders and all your volunteers for the work they've done, particularly on the Lane property, but over the years on all of our wonderful trails and conservation lands. I appreciate it, and I think the town appreciates it quite a bit.
Good. Good.
Shall I read the proclamation?
Absolutely.
Town of Lunenburg Proclamation. Whereas the Town of Lunenburg has conservation land dedicated to activities such as bird watching, cross-country skiing, snowshoeing, hiking, nature study, photography, and other passive recreational uses, and whereas volunteers are a valuable resource on which the town depends and appreciates for the upkeep and maintenance of many trails going over the conservation land, as well as installation of bridges, and whereas Peter Charpentier, a lifelong resident of Lunenburg, passionate hiker and outdoorsman, contributed many volunteer hours towards the conservation land, and whereas the Lunenburg Conservation Commission are the caretakers and stewards of the Lane conservation land and voted at their December 7th, 2016 meeting to dedicate the Mulpris Brook Multipurpose Bridge in memory of Peter Charpentier, who passed away on August 17th. Now, therefore, it is fitting that the Lunenburg Board of Selectmen do hereby proclaim that we honor the memory and celebrate the life of Peter Charpentier, an exceptional individual, and ratifies the Conservation Commission vote to dedicate the bridge on this day, December 20th, 2016.
I so move.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you so much. So the only thing I would request is we will have some in the spring, some
dedication
gathering at the bridge and a dedication. If I could extend the invitation,
absolutely,
that would be awesome.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tom.
Thank you.
See you soon.
Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah.
Okay. Committee reports, Mrs. Luck.
Last evening was the first meeting of the school strategic visioning steering committee. We are working on a strategic framework and will be seeking community input. It's the first of three phases. It will result in the creation of a district strategic plan, which will then inform the school improvement plans going forward. And hopefully we'll all be rowing in the same direction, and it will direct the way the schools spend their money, their resources, the culture, and the climate. We're looking forward to working on that. Our next meeting is January 12th. The next Stormwater Task Force meeting is an educational workshop on January 12th. Last week, I attended a Bay State Roads workshop out in Hadley, getting the most out of your snow and ice operations. And I had heard things at other stormwater workshops about how communities were using much less sand and therefore not having to clean their catch basins as much and not having as much pollution runoff. And I was hoping to find out some information, and I my hopes were realized 100%. The presenter had been the DPW director out in Heath for like 20 years, and Heath is a fairly small community in northwestern Massachusetts. It has about the same land area as Lunenburg, but the population's much smaller. They also have, at that point, they had already had 16 inches of snow, so they get a lot of snow out in that area. And their elevations range from 300 feet to 2,400 feet. So challenging work, roadways. And when he began his career as a DPW director, he was a sand man. And through education and learning, they don't use any sand at all anymore in his town. It used to take them 3 years to clean all the catch basins. Now they do it in a week. They pre-treat, they just use salt. He said that when you just use salt, you use less salt than when you mix salt with sand. It was just a really interesting presentation, and obviously not something you could do overnight, but it's something to move toward, because certainly for our MS4 permit, if you eliminated sand, that would really be a big jump in.
A question on that. Is there, obviously within a watershed, you don't want the sodium chloride levels to get too high. So how do they mitigate the impacts of salt?
You know, I'm not really sure. I have actually reached out and asked him about that, because I was thinking the same thing after the workshop. But it's interesting. He said you actually use less salt than you would use if you used sand and salt. Part of it is they pre-treat, and sometimes they use liquid salt, sometimes they use rock salt. It's not really simple, it didn't seem like, so it wasn't something you could do overnight. But it sounds like a great goal to work for. And the presenter said that he'd come out here and talk to us.
Great.
And he's he retired from the DPW director and now just works for Bay State Roads and does pavement management workshops and just a whole series of workshops for Bay State Roads. The ZBA has one hearing scheduled for January 11th, which involves a tear down and rebuild at 55 Spring Street over on Lake Shirley. And Lisa Normandin informed me that Ray Beal has tendered his resignation effective 12/31. The entire board, as I'm sure the rest of the town, is sad to see him leave, but we are grateful for more than his decade of service to the town. The ZBA will reorganize the board at the next meeting. Alfred Gravel is the vice chair. Ray's leaving the board with four members. They need five, but they've got two associates. So you would think that they'll probably be able to just fill the ranks and come up to five.
That'll be part of my town manager reports.
Oh.
Okay.
I'm done.
All right.
Great reports, Mrs. Bertram.
The only report I have is from Montechuset Metropolitan Planning Organization, or the MPO, which met on December 14th. There was an amendment to the Transportation Improvement Program for 2017 to 2021, and it was really on the transit element. There's been some adjustments on spending within the proposed TIP, and that's been released for public comment and can be found. The details on that can be found on the MRPC website. We also talked about the proposed TIP schedule, which will be starting in January, which is and we'll be working very aggressively on the next TIP. We also had a presentation on the regional population projections analysis, and it was interesting. They looked at the standard way that they've done population projections using census data and trends, and then we had a presentation using what they call the Hamilton-Perry method, and there was a presentation on using a cohort component method, which is a different methodology, and it just looked at the age of people. I think we are all aware we have an aging population across the region. and, but it also looked at the percentage of change by population, projected population. And it was interesting to note that for specifically for Lunenburg, in the old method for 2010 to 2020, they recommended, they suggested that we would have a decrease in population of 2.8%. But using this method, it looks like we would have a population increase of 4.6%. So it's just an interesting thing to look at. And from a planning perspective, Adam, you might want to check this out on the website. 2020 to 2030, it looked like we would have a negative 3.2% decrease in population. But now, using this methodology, we would have an increase of 1.7%. And then finally, in 2030 to 2040, it was projected we'd have a decrease of 6%. This is showing a decrease of 2%. So it's certainly showing a more of a population increase than the original projections that were utilized. We had some updates on the MassDOT Highway Division, and one of the things that was very interesting and something I think we should move on is that there will be $2 million available in next year's TIP because the project has kind of fallen off the plate. So if we have a project, and my mind brings me to Chase Road, that is shovel-ready, we want to contact the Brad Harris of MRPC and let him know that we want to move that project forward. But any community within the region that has a project that they believe is ready to go for 2017 should get that information to MRPC, because that's one of the things we'll be talking about at our next meeting. So this construction of Summer Street did come up, and Sarah Bradbury of Mass District 3 said that the 100% design for Summer Street has been received, and they are reviewing it, and it's been distributed to the various offices of MassDOT. And I was a little bit concerned because, you know, she said, we still think it will be ready, but we need to make sure of some things, so we certainly want to follow up on that and make sure that that moves forward. Right now, if they stay on track, the construction schedule, according to Sarah, she's predicting next fall or next spring. So I want to touch base with Trish and make sure that we're going to hit those milestones. Another thing of interest was the Wachusett Station is fully operational, and, you know, are operating at full service. The grand opening has been postponed because of the cold weather, so that date will be to be determined. And there is a shuttle between Gardner Center and Wachusett Station, which was interesting. The parking design for AIR, which is relevant to people in Lunenburg, they're working on that plan, and that will have a 200 parking space garage. And Mass Development and all the businesses in Devens are in a meeting to talk about transportation options. They're looking to get transportation from outlying areas to Devens specifically, so for people that don't have transportation, but to get them actually to Devens. As I said earlier, they're looking to assist communities with complete streets. The dedicated local technical assistance grant, which was questionable whether it was going to receive funding, did receive funding. So if we have any tasks in Lunenburg that we would like to have considered for funding under that grant, we should forward them to MRPC for consideration. I did ask them to send the bike rack purchase information to Adam. I did get it.
Yeah.
So I did ask them to send that out. And then finally, they are looking to assist communities with ecotourism projects. Oh. And that's something that we have talked about. So they are looking to showcase some trails in various communities and assist with brochures for ecotourism. And I thought that was something we would be very interested in. So I talked with Sherry Bean after the meeting. And she said to send her some contact information for people, so I'm going to send her some contact information from the Conservation Commission as well as Adam. But I think that's something we should really pursue, because that could certainly help us with our economic development plan. And that's it. Sorry, I was long-winded.
That's fine.
Mr. Ebersole. The library has been working on various of its policies to update them to make sure they're consistent, and including look at the use of their library trust funds for purchase of books. Sewer Commission is working on updating their rules and regulations, particularly with enforcement and following up on requirements to make sure that people are doing what they're supposed to do on an efficient way. That's it.
I just have one. The Building Reuse Committee met last evening primarily to review the input from the special town meeting and to plan next steps. For clarity purposes, the committee voted to revise the RFP plan to create a four, let me do this in two parts, to create one four-building individual RFPs. So to keep it from being confused, our current proposal is to reuse the Passios as a municipal office building. So one RFP package would be the other four buildings, the primary school, the town hall, the Brooks House, and the Ritter, and requesting proposals to use them or do something with them to create a revenue base, a taxable revenue base or something, to fund the renovation of the Passios as a municipal building. That was the original proposal. Then a separate package that would put out an RFP for all five buildings or any portion of those five buildings for a town center concept. And that was the vision that we talked about that was a little more visionary, if you will. If someone wanted to use any or all of the five buildings and come up with a town center concept, as long as that town center concept encompassed a municipal office building as part of it. It wouldn't necessarily have to be the Passios, but as part of the town center concept, there would be an office, a municipal office building. So they would be the two RFPs. Now, the committee also understands that we have quite a bit of work to do to create the criteria, work the communications, socialize that among the town, and all of this will be designed to be culminating with an award process that wraps around the annual town meeting. Our current calendar says that we'd like to get the RFPs out in such a way so that they would be, we would get a response to them, we'd be able to communicate that to the town, talk about the pluses and minuses, and make the annual town meeting as was voted at the special town meeting, the vehicle for up or down on any of those RFPs.
So you're going to be busy.
No, yeah. I was just going to say, that's a really aggressive schedule.
The plan is for us to do all our homework, get our criteria to, Adam's going to be our collector of the information and then disperser of it out again. We would orientate our new town manager, who's also a certified procurement officer, and our next meeting is actually the 30th of January. When we meet, yeah, and when we meet with the town manager, procurement officer, with all this homework done, we'll begin to build a plan that lays out a calendar from there through issuing an RFP, getting a response to the RFP, and wrapping that around an annual town meeting. Now, the thought came up, that's still our target, but the thought also came up that if things are going well and the timing's off, It wouldn't be a horrible use of town funds to have a special town meeting for just that purpose.
Right.
And what we said is we really want the largest attendance possible. We were a little disappointed in only having 50 to 70 people at the special town meeting, so we're shooting for the annual town meeting. But we believe that if that timing doesn't work or if this board decides it's a better thing to have a special town meeting just for that purpose, that's certainly a possibility.
So when do you think the criteria will be out for people to come? You're going to share that with people and before it goes out?
My guess would be it'll be developed at the January 30th meeting, and it would go out as part of the communication would be as part of the RFP process.
This board would have to review and be on board with the language before it was issued.
No sooner than the 30th of January is the answer.
Great. Thank you.
Okay.
And one other thing, just a kind of a side issue. I happened to sit on the Capital Planning Committee and shared with the Reuse Committee that there is a request in the Capital Plan for scraping lead paint removal and repair, trim, and painting of Town Hall. And they, not that they're in the you know, approval cycle, but they unanimously supported that as something that they would appreciate being part of the capital plan. The amount is $87,750. So, you know, we have to prioritize that. It'll be part of the budget. It'll come to this group. It'll come to the FinCom. But as part of the reuse, nobody's saying we shouldn't do that.
Mm-hmm. If anything, it might improve the saleability of the property.
Exactly.
I applaud the plan. I think it's a very aggressive plan, and if we're not able to make the annual town meeting, you know, my thought is, if we need to have a special, I would just suggest we do something similar to what the school building committee did, which was to attend all of the different venues and try to, you know, really, once we decide as a board and as a building reuse which plan we believe is the best option, we need to make sure that the townspeople are aware of it, and the way we do that is to get out in the community and show them. Mm-hmm. So that's my only concern about trying to make an annual, but I think that if we're able to attend some of those meetings and have public hearings and really get the public aware of what's trying to be done, I think if we had to have a special, we could get the attendance that we're looking for.
Right.
Thank you.
Town manager report?
I do have reports this time.
Good.
We'll start with the simple one, which already has been broached. The ZBA chair has resigned, so there are two alternates currently sitting on the board, so this body will have to take one of those and make them a full member. I will work with the ZBA clerk to reach out and see if one or both are interested. If neither are interested in being a full member, then, you know, we end up into a different realm of recruitment. But ultimately, the Board of Selectmen has to be the one who designates the full member. The zoning board just can't decide which one is going to do it. So that's something you'll probably be seeing in the next, I'll say, month or so.
I would think that the zoning board would make a recommendation, though, wouldn't they?
I don't know if they will, because these are two people that have been alternates. So
yeah, I mean, it's not two random people. It's people who are involved with the board, and I think it would be.
I mean, we have to decide. I mean, they know them better.
I don't know. If they both want to be full-time members, my thought is if the ZBA wants to make a recommendation, fantastic. However, if they don't, I would think that we need to have an interview process, and mm-hmm. then we would make that decision. Mm-hmm.
I mean, it'd be good if they, you know,
decide amongst themselves.
Well, no, but if they fill out the talent bank application,
yes,
or something similar,
sure,
to that, of why they would like to be. But no matter what, if we select from that or if we select somebody else, there's going to be an appointment process.
Correct.
Beyond that. So it's good to get it out there saying that there's a vacancy for at least the alternate, if not the full.
Right.
Mm-hmm. All right. Number two, the fire department, through the chief, is looking at the applications for the staffing for adequate fire and emergency response grants. It's called the SAFER grant, in a move to bring the town closer to 24-hour service on the paramedic level. That would be an opportunity for the community to receive some outside funding to assist with that. The application period, he's not sure when it will open, but it's coming sometime in the next month. And he just wanted to make the board aware that they will be submitting an application. There's no obligation with the application. If you make it through the first screening, they send you a letter saying, you know, hey, congratulations, you guys are awesome, we might give you some money. If we give it to you, are you going to follow through with these other obligations? And at that point, you have the opportunity to say, no, we can't do that, or yes, we can. And that's
the. Do you know what the proposal is that he's going to be putting forth? Is it for training for paramedic? Is it for additional personnel? Do you know what his proposal
is? He didn't inform me what the proposal was. He just wanted to make the board aware that that grant program is coming up.
Yes.
He is working on an internal proposal, but he said he's not complete with it yet, and it will be something he'll be bringing forward to the town in the future.
Okay.
So when he finds out whether he's eligible for the grant or been accepted for
mm-hmm.
consideration, then he'll bring it to us?
At that point, he'd bring the grant to you, and I have to believe either then or before then he will have broached the subject of what his plan is to bring the department to that level.
Right. obviously.
I mean, I don't think he's going to come to you and say, well, they might give us money. Can you just commit to it and then, you know, have a whole different level of expectation? But this is more of an informational, this is coming, he plans to pursue it, and on the back of that, there are some other internal discussions to be had.
The fire chief reports to the town manager?
Yes.
Okay. So I just want to make sure that we understand that we're not in charge of the fire department, but we want to be kept informed.
Mm-hmm. And the third is on January 10th, we have a group coming to broach the subject of cannabis cultivation within the town of Lunenburg. They have a site that they're proposing. There will be no retail or registered medical dispensary. It would only be cultivation. It would all be within a building, and it would all be for growing, processing, and shipping off to other registered medical dispensaries outside of the region. So just sort of a heads up, you can start doing your homework if you want, so you can have questions prepared.
Where does that comes to us? Who's the authority?
Well, the planning board is the issuing authority for a special permit for indoor cultivation.
Okay.
What this individual is looking to do is not tie the facility to a license, but rather permit the construction of essentially a greenhouse. An indoor structure where they will be growing plants. It was done recently in Freetown by I believe it's a Denver-based company that this gentleman's not affiliated with, but it's an analogous proposal.
Greenhouse?
Yes, down near Fall River and Rehoboth. And they're constructing a million square foot greenhouse. This guy's is a smaller scale than that. And they permitted the greenhouse as a development. And then they will be soliciting leases from registered marijuana dispensaries and potentially, going forward, recreational distributors. And when you are licensed through the state, you then work through with the town assigning that license to the facility where they're growing. So when the selectmen don't necessarily have any play in the construction of the facility,
but the permitting
of a medical growing facility will probably require the selectmen to either support or vote no opposition.
Because we're the licensing authority.
Well, but you're not the licensing authority. The way that the Department of Public Health has written the regulations for medical marijuana, it requires communities to, at a minimum, not oppose the location of the facility.
It's their license, but we have to weigh in.
Correct, you have to weigh in that, so the state isn't shoving things down municipal throats, at least in this instance.
And is this building considered a farm? Is this going to be in a commercial? Where does this
fit? Well, it's larger than 5 acres, and so I believe it would enjoy the protections of agriculture, but our medical marijuana bylaw requires that indoor cultivation be approved by special permit.
Okay.
And I think that some of that is due to the size and nature of these buildings and the implications that they could have on abutting properties or surrounding neighborhoods. So things like sight lines, noise, scent, etc., would certainly be a large part of that review.
And when will the planning board be complete with their review? Do you have any?
He has not filed anything.
So my question would be, you know, January 10th is fine for an informational reason, for hearing and to find out about it. My concern would be, you know, I would want the feedback and the insight of the planning board.
Oh, and I think that that's reasonable. I've met with this gentleman several times. He broached the subject with me probably more than 9 months ago, just kind of kicking the tires. You know, I'm looking at 8 different communities. I've got a spot here. We had a lot of discussions. And at the time, it was originally going to be tied to a dispensary that he was involved with. And as things have evolved, he decided he didn't want to move in that direction initially. So in our last meeting, which was just yesterday, he said, well, what do I need to do? I said, well, you can just file with the planning board. You can just file your special permit. And he said, really, I want to approach the selectmen. I want to start putting out education and having a discussion. I don't think he's looking for any sort of
action.
Final vote or action on the 10th.
Okay.
He's done this in another community in Massachusetts where his dispensary is located. He said he spent 6 months talking to the selectmen, going through the process, coming back, answering questions, providing information. So he's been very flexible. He's been very upfront. I think it's more he just wants to start the dialogue. And he feels that this is the better place to start it than, hey, I've got a development plan. Let's kind of start talking about that.
Okay.
I'd be interested in them coming prepared to talk about how much tax revenue we would get from
and
the building.
We certainly can talk about that. He has mentioned some plans that he has as far as what he feels is a viable pilot payment on top of whatever taxes he would be paying. I think that he recognizes that he's stepping into what's potentially a lucrative industry, and I don't believe he's looking to, again, you know, I don't know the gentleman that well, but in our conversations, he's been very open about being willing to foot what he feels is his portion of the bill.
It might be a good location for a solar panel on top of the big building, too.
Let's do it. Perhaps
I think the buildings are made of glass, so the solar might...
Stormwater collection area.
Yeah.
Aquaculture for the marijuana. Just do it all.
But that's just an FYI, so it's not a surprise when you get your agenda for that meeting.
Thank you.
That's all I have.
The last agenda item is the actual resignation letter from Ray Beal. I'll just read it quickly. It's with great regret that I tender my resignation from the Zoning Board of Appeals effective December 31, 2016. I would like to have had a full complement of associate members from which your board could fill the empty regular member slot. I am grateful for having had the opportunity to serve the ZBA for more than a decade now. It's been a great experience, and I shall miss it. Sincerely, Ray Beal.
I move we accept the resignation.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All righty. From a scheduling point of view, we have scheduled a meeting for the 27th of December. Very brief meeting, a hearing, if that needs to be done, and probably signing a warrant or two. And if that does not, if the hearing doesn't require to happen, we will not have that meeting. And our first meeting of the new year is January 3rd.
So will we probably
know? You'll know tomorrow. I anticipate. Well, Thursday. Oh, no, we can post Thursday. But I anticipate you'll be meeting on Tuesday.
This is the kebabalicious
right.
Follow-up
yes.
Hearing.
Exactly.
And that hearing, they've been duly notified? And
oh, yes, there. Yes.
It's all scheduled to happen. It's just if everything comes in, we could choose to accept it and not have
okay.
The hearing. Any public comment from the public? Any public comment from the board?
I've got one sort of an action item, too, which I should have brought before. We talked about earth removal bylaw update, which we talked about before, and I know you've got a lot of things to do, but I see that of more importance regarding what we've talked about a couple of times about what's gone on in Uxbridge, where soil from other communities is being trucked in to fill in past gravel removal, mm-hmm. And I just want us to get ahead of that. There are state reviews, but the question is whether the state reviews are sufficient. And it seems like the Keating operation seems to be even being doing more work, and I would think that they are our largest gravel removal mm-hmm. permit process, and I'd want to make sure that we have things in place that we deal with that. And if we can do something for town meeting, fine, but I don't want to force something.
Mm-hmm.
I see you wincing, being that's why I'm sort of making sure we keep this on our agenda, because then if we have a special town meeting sometime after...
Something to tag on at the end.
About that.
So you're talking, taking the earth removal bylaw and maybe altering it to an earth alteration bylaw to include removal and fill?
Right.
I know some communities have an earth removal and an earth fill. I think the two could probably be combined into one, have a process that's universal, and then regulations for removal, regulation requirements for fill.
Right.
Okay.
Because our current bylaw talks about that we have the right to require a plan for remediation, a closure.
Mm-hmm.
So we in some ways have some authority to do that, but it's the state of the art and what happens with the groundwater and everything else like that really has changed from when we wrote the bylaw originally in the 60s. So I think that whether it's two separate bylaws, I know that when you were before us before, you talked about whether it should be with the selectmen or whether mm-hmm. it should be with the planning board. We should explore that. And just the regular earth removal bylaw needs to be updated. And then when you actually start putting dirt back in wherever we have the places,
mm-hmm.
We should be talking about that as well.
You know, to be frank and honest, I think that maybe shooting for a special in the fall may be more realistic. Mm-hmm. With the use table that we're working on the planning board, RFPs, and then sort of adding in a lot of the components that you're talking about, I think there's a wider discussion to be had, and we might do ourselves a service to have the breathing room of November as a or October as a target.
I mean, clearly it came up during the development project off of Elmwood Road and that earth mm-hmm. removal. Earth filling would be the Walmart,
yep.
Hannaford place. So we have had some past
sure.
filling already.
Yeah. And there is case law about earth removal in conjunction with other permitting,
right.
and additional permits for that earth removal are, you get into a hinky area, but we do have a lot of removal that is just the use in and of itself.
Thank you.
So when they refill in Uxbridge, they just bring it in from other places?
Right. So they got a DEP, I think it's a DEP permit.
Yeah.
And that soil was theoretically tested where it was removed. It had low-level contamination. And the question becomes, what is the definition of low-level? And the question is, how many trucks actually have to be tested, and
mm-hmm.
how it's filled and how it's trucked and other things like that. So it's a complicated situation. That town also had the issue that the owner of the property, the owner of the trucking company, was also on the Conservation Commission, so there was some local politics that made it of more intensity.
Yes.
But there were other communities that are having the same question going on, and what happens when the big dig project was going on, this was happening more often because you had more earth being removed. And so if we are in a process of economic development and there's more projects going on out there, we may be more likely to get some development. If water eventually goes into Lancaster and there's development down there, they may want to have place to put soil as well. And Keating's would be certainly the closest place for that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not opposed to what's going on. I'm just saying we need to just be ahead of it before.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and it's not a matter of what's happening. It's right. What could happen.
Right. It's not right. A crisis right, right at the moment.
Okay. Any other public comment? I'd just like to wish everybody a Merry Christmas, Happy Hanukkah, safe holiday season. And I will not be here on the 3rd, so a Happy New Year. Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.